So hello everybody, thank you for being here. I'm very glad to be here with you, and I want to thank the CHS for inviting me, Lana for being the host and organizing everything, and of course Brian Sneeden, who is a friend and a translator of my work some years now.
Νόστος 6. Ο γλάρος τα μέτρησε τα φτερά σου. Η θάλασσα σε καλεί, μα δεν τη θέλεις. Σε πονάει το μέγεθός της.
The seagull takes the measurement of your wings. The sea calls you, but you do not want it. You ache at its magnitude.
Here and I go. I am an architect graduated from the Athens Polytechnic School. I have a PhD in classics. I am a poet, I am a professor. I am a woman, a mother of two kids. I happen to be manifold in many ways. At some point of my trajectory, I started addressing issues coming from my scholarly background in classics inside my poetic work. I will review today these issues and the way they evolved inside some of my projects. This multiple way is what I call chimeric poetics, a term I think can apply to multiple artists of today. Anne Carson has shown the way by mixing the genre and the media. Jesper Svenbrug, a professor of mine, also, even if he kept genres and media separate. So a first and crucial issue for poetry, as far as I am concerned, is in Socrates' words, to know oneself, which Socrates in Phaedrus answers, offering two alternatives. I am either a simple being or a complex one, as Typhon or Chimera. So Chimera. Chimera is a composite being. A seagull, a hybrid creature composed of parts, various members, meli, melos, a part, a member, a tune, a melody. So to this question I answer, as I cannot do otherwise, with the identity of the many. Not only my identity, but my writing itself is polymorphic, and I also use multiple media. Connected with the question, who am I, is the issue of the poetic voice. What is the I of the poem? Who is the I speaking? Mikhail Bakhtin defined polyphony as the main features of the novel, in contrast to lyrical poetry, which is monophonic. Can we imagine a non-monophonic, a polyphonic poetry? Together with this questioning comes the following consideration, dating in Derrida. Are there any ways to resist the canon? Carnophalogocentrisme, as he named it, resist dominance and discrimination, human race, gender, logocentric dominance of the world inside the world in poetry. Mightn't the poetic eye be merely a mask, I thought, that as such could embody more than one speaker's? In ancient Greek lyric poetry, the I is a performative I, spoken by a chorus, a collective I that belongs to, or an I acting out a role in a ritual. This I, in other words, is the mask, and the persons behind it may alternate. A third stable concern of my work has been the architecture of the reading material, the reading object. So, first beginning the place. The poem you heard comes from my book, Homerica. In 2006, I had just moved in Pelion. Every place around resounded as a name and a myth. Peleus, Achilles, Argo, Iason, Centaur, Thetis, Cape, Sepias. And I began to use the myth as a filter between me and my writing. I dress my poetic language with its hypocritical clothes. This investment in myth coincided with the beginning of the performative presentation of my poetry. For this, I owe a lot to my meeting with a giant poet, Barbara Keller, that we lost very recently, and her work. If we take into consideration the etymology of ego, I, egom from here, edo, as Jesper Svenbru mentions in Phrasiclia, and I like to quote, the I speaking is not a person, but a place with all the beings which inhabit it. And as the voice delivers verses, it encounters all the beings that can be heard at that place. The articulation of the voice in the landscape introduces a founding multiplicity. It is not me who is speaking. It is merely the voice of the place. The myth, writes Stathis Gourgouris, is the material of a performative act. So during a 2-day wandering on Pelion Mountain, I read the poems and I recorded them to record the exact moment and its uniqueness. I incorporated the CD in the book. Next project, Tethics. The singing cicada in ancient literary production, mainly the Platonic Phaedrus, Hesiod and Archilochus, but also Homer and other poets, is the first animal emblematic construction of the poetic voice I dealt with. Leisure, heat, sun, dry skin, cicada's voice spilled into the earth in erotic lustiness is the way Hesiod portraits the summer season. Inside the cicada's voice, we feel the presence of summer. The acoustic dimension of this incomprehensible song is a resonant symbolism for all poetry. In Phaedrus, we read the philosophic myth for the cicada poet. I work on it. As I worked also on the life cycle and especially the cicada's disrobing, metamorphosis, its coming of age through getting rid of the previous exoskeleton and the simultaneous emergence of wings. I interpret the whole as a cicada simile for the lover and the poet. The poet, Socrates in Phaedrus, the lover, the child, a chimera, a being under metamorphosis in order to be able to sing, to speak to the others, about the others, and about that which is other. The cicada in the tree, sucking its juices, is the poetic voice as the metabolism of the environment. The book object Tethics is made up of 10 AA4 pages of scanned manuscripts which are contained loose without binding inside the cover folder. They were initially created for the installation Tethics at the National Museum for Contemporary Art, curated by Stamatis Kizakis. There, they were placed on an equal number of lecterns, inviting the visitors to deliver the texts. The book's format, as well as the way the text is laid out on the pages, resists fixity and functions as a musical score. It exists in direct response to the space of the exhibition. I have selected textual fragments from various origins, and I chose the 2-page format after looking at the Venetus A manuscripts of the Iliad at the Marcian Library of Venice. I copied the excerpts like the monastic scribes of the Middle Ages. On each page, you can see there is a main column that occupies the center in large print, and next to it, a narrow column in smaller letters. The large column contains the reference texts, either in the original or in Greek translation that I did, while the small ones are my poems, new poems. In the context of the installation, a polyphonic reading was performed by 10 readers. Γενέθλια.
Birthday.
Φαγουρίζουν τα φτερά όταν βγαίνουν.
Do the wings itch as they sprout?
Όταν από την έξοδο της κοιλιάς έβγαλες πρώτα το κεφάλι και σπρώχνοντας από τον πόνο πετάχτηκες έξω στο φως για να φωνάξεις, ήταν τα μάτια σου ανοιχτά?
When from the belly's opening you first raised your head and pushing from the pain sprang into the light to cry out, were your eyes open?
Άκουσες τα λόγια αυτών που σε κρατούσαν, βοηθώντας, όλο το σώμα συστραμμένο, μαζεμένο, τα πόδια λυγισμένα, κι η μέρα ζεστή.
Did you listen to their words as they held gently your contorted body, gathered, legs tucked, and the day warm?
Μια γυναίκα γεννούσε στο αυτοκινήτου της στο πάτωμα. Κάθε μεγάλωμα άραγε πονάει σαν το πρώτο. Δεν μεγαλώνει κανείς με τον ίδιο ρυθμό, αδιόρατα.
A woman giving birth on the floor of her car, is each growth painful as the first? Doesn't one grow at the same pulse, imperceptibly?
Ή μήπως μετά από περίοδου στάσης, έφνης, η κίνηση σε κατακτά και αυξάνεσαι και ανυπόφορα αλλάζεις. Πετάς από πάνω σου σαν το λουλούδι τα πέταλα μέσα στη δρόσο που ρουφάς κάτι παλιό και ξανά.
Or is it after periods of stasis, when motion seizes you suddenly and you grow and are unbearably changed, do you cast off the old, like the flower, its petals, and the dew that you suck again and again?
Κατοικημένος από τις νύχτας της αγωνίας, ανοίγεις τα πρωινά σου μάτια ανάποδα να κοιτάξεις τον κόσμο.
Inhabited by night's afflictions, do you open your morning eyes slantwise to survey the world? Cicadas too, winged words, for mitzos. From drums in the viscera, a cicada screams, song of gathering, marked by weather fluctuations and the dance of the other male, chant of premarital rituals, song of annoyances, croak of protest in captivity. When you catch its wing, seized a cicada by the wing. The summer my brother ate a cicada, it fluttered and screeched, alien voice from the fence of the teeth. When the mouth opened, the cicada took off, flying. They call you cicada, you always face the sea.
Ah. After the cicada, my attention has been turned to other animals, emblematic poetic figures for ancient Greek poetry. For my project, Aegeo or Chimera, I worked with the goats, animals that one can find inside the word tragedy. Tragedy, the song of the billy goat. Instead of the he goat, I worked on the she goat, the chimera, that was the first meaning of the word. I also worked on the words nomos and nomi, which link the land with the animals, with the distribution of the voice. I did a 2 years anthropological research inside the community of shepherds practicing transhumans. These shepherds are blacks, belonging to a minority, a community of nomadic breeders that came to Greece in the 13th century, speaking Vlachica, a language of Latin descendants. Here is the shepherd, Yanis Moutos. They are nomads. They move in spring and autumn from the mountains to the plain and vice versa. You can see here in red, a small, very light line, which is their trajectory inside Greece. And here you can see Aristotle speaking about nomad stock breeders. So some principal issues I had to face with this work. First, the ethnographic side, for Chimera is also the product of an amateur ethnographic survey and its relation to poetry. Two, symmetrically, poetry as ethnography and documentary poetics. Three, the question of the beast and the sovereign, as Jacques Derrida has put it, and here, for Chimera, I can analyze more concretely as the question of the sovereign voice and its relation to the subordinated or subaltern, as Spivak poses it, voice. So, is the sovereign the man, shepherd, and subaltern the animal? Is the sovereign the center and the city, and the subaltern the countryside? Is the sovereign the male and the subaltern the female? Is the sovereign the state and the subaltern the bandit? Is the sovereign the Greek nationality as Greek language and history, and the subordinate the Vlach minority language and history? Is the sovereign the man and the subaltern the woman and child? Is the sovereign the written and the subordinate the oral? Or is the sovereign the literate and subordinate the illiterate? Is the sovereign the fixed and subaltern the nomad and the moving? Is the sovereign the one that stays in memory and subaltern that which is forgotten? These focal issues I tried to address by two techniques. The one is the assemblage of the voices which I collected first as an archive and which aim to the polyvocality, as the ethnographer James Clifford is asserting about the ultimate way of writing ethnography, following Bakhtin, and the other is the impersonating of the other's eye by writing and performing, a kind of becoming by means of writing. So that's the most problematic. The writing for the subaltern or the other with whom I do not share language, as it happens with the animals. This is a question of mimesis. A mimesis in the way Gregory Nash puts it, as its first more archaic meaning, impersonating a model. And what do I share with the animals? I came to answer in a very simple way. It is life that I do share with the animals, the common destiny of death, the feelings of joy and fear. And for me, it was also the nomadic life of changing places, which I did at the same period. And it was the love and affect of the mother for the child, which from which she separated us. Thank you. where you hear their mating. Dogs.
Puckville says, the dogs that belong to the black shepherds are Molossian hounds, fearless and brave, with eyes lit with a kind of fire, ears alert to catch even the slightest noises, vigilant sentinels, friends of the hearth, the family, their masters, for whom they would splinter into a thousand pieces. They step proudly at the front of the herd, which they contain without even once leaving their teeth marks. They contain the land around them for fear of wolves, which they attack and nearly always win.
I go. To learn about the goats, I spoke with a shepherd. He was from a nomadic people. Spring on the mountain, fall in the valley. He was a seaman. After he retired, he came back to the herd. He was strict with them. He cursed the politicians. I asked him for his dog. He said, not a chance. There was no way he'd ever give it to me.
William Martin Leake says, the shepherds of Capinas would graft a fragment of bone from a dog's foot about 2 inches long into the side of a grown sheep. They would open up the flesh, place the bone in, and sew the wound closed again. This procedure had two benefits. For one, it fortified the stamina and vitality of the sheep for the mountain's harsh weather, but it also calloused the flesh, imparting a foul smell wolves didn't want any part of.
I goat. To learn about the goats, I stole from the shepherd his dog. Now it lives with me in the city. It's good with strangers, though sometimes it can be a little aggressive, but out of affection, because I am both the shepherd that feeds it and the goat it must guard.
Edward Daniel Clark says, in East Katerini, I met a group of Arnold shepherds armed with large pistols and knives. It was strange to us how they clothed their sheepdogs to keep them from the cold.
I goat. You said I am your goat and you are my dog.
Yanis Zevriko says, I emptied my rucksack and what food I had, I offered to one of my cousin's dogs I found watching over two newborns. Throughout the night, it laid curled so the goats could nestle against its body, near its belly.
I go. Caring for another saves you from your dominant self.
Yanis Zevriko says, their feeding time is just before the herd is let out to graze and right after it comes back. At the day's start and close, the dog is the first and last concern.
The narrator says, for centuries, they fed the dogs. Black bread, made from wheat, bran, not yeast, and in the same basin where they needed the dog bread, women gave birth if a baby came during the sedentary season.
Dimitris Lukopoulos says, somewhere out there, the sheepdog opens and closes its eyes, and the shepherd farther off, in the thick shade of a fir tree, or perhaps a cedar, lying on his belly or his back, depending on the moods of sleep, drinks the polished air of ridge and wood.
I goat. I am accompanied by the most yours and delicate first voice. I am accompanied by your breath.
Lukopoulos says, in the deepest shade, the shepherd sleeps. The dog sleeps. Above all, solitude and stillness.
Κύκλοπς. Είμαι κλεισμένη στη σπηλιά του κύκλοπα.
I'm locked inside the cave of the Cyclops.
Το ένα μοναδικό του μάτι με φρουρί.
With his solitary eye guarding me.
Εγώ αγρυπνώ.
I stay awake.
Κύκλοπα, άνοιξέ μου την πόρτα.
Cyclops, open the door for me.
Κύκλοπα, άφησέ με να φύγω.
Cyclops, let me leave.
Ο κύκλοπας χαϊδεύει το τρίχωμα της ράχης μου.
The cyclops caresses the fuzz on my back.
Ανάβει φωτιά.
Lights a fire.
Τρίβει τα χέρια.
Rubs his hands.
Τρώει το κρέας, το τυρί, το κρασί μου.
Eats my meat, my cheese, my wine.
Κοιμάται ευτυχισμένος ενώ με φυλάει.
Sleeps happily, still guarding me.
Ρεύεται.
Burps.
Με το ένα μοναδικό του μάτι ανοιχτό.
With his solitary eye open.
Συνέχιστο μιλήσαμε πουρές του, σαν τρόπο. Και η γυναίκα που κούρυψα την παρούλα. Την παρούλα μη λέει να μην κουρέψει. Πρέπει να δημάσει η γυναίκα πώς την κουρέψει. Έβρα κούρυψε, μη λέει, την κούρυψα. Αυτά είναι χαρίσματα στον άνθρωπο. Δεν μπορούσα να τα βρεις με τίποτες. Εγώ γεννήθηκα για αυτή τη δουλειά. Άμα μου πεις τι παράγει την τροφία, είμαι μέσα να σταθώ τα πάντα. Τα πάντα δεν υπάρχει τίποτα. Γιατί από τα γενοφάσκια που ξεκίνησα ήμουν μέσα.
Midday. A row of cypresses towered over the road. We knelt at the water source, drank its cleanness. Plane trees shaded the ground, shaded the brown on brown, tufts, wool from shearing, the residue of hands on the bodies of animals. In Easter, the ditch water purples, and the square huddled together, awaiting the sacrifice. The chosen offering bleats. The flesh, food for human meals, shared with wine, wine blood, wine bread, dirt. A soul surrounded by a body, Empedocles says. Earth surrounding the mortal, earth surrounding the perishable, earth surrounding the already dead.
Smaller animals are raised above the altar and the throat is cut. The blood is collected in a basin and sprayed over the altar and against the sides. To stain the altar with blood is a pious duty. As the fatal blow falls, the women must cry out in high, shrill tones. The animal is skinned and butchered. The heart and the liver are roasted on the fire of the altar first of all. Occasionally the heart is torn still beating from the body before all else. To taste the entrails immediately is the privilege and duty of the innermost cycle of participants. The inedible remains are then consecrated. The bones are laid on the pyre, prepared on the altar in just order. In Homer, beginning from all limbs of the animal, small pieces of meat are also placed on the pyre. The dismembered creature is to be reconstituted symbolically. The fundamental structure of sacrifice is identical and clear. Animal sacrifice is ritualized slaughter followed by a meat meal.
So, I presented the results of this anthropological research and the poetic related production in an exhibition made in collaboration with my fellow professor at the University of Thessaly, architect Iris Lykouriotis. We gave it the title Aegeo, τα τραγούδια, Aegean Land of Goats, the Odes of Goats. The exhibition took place in a museum that used formerly to be the house of an eminent woman, Αγγελική Χατζημιχάλη, who lived from 1895 to 1965. Αγγελική Χατζημιχάλη was a pioneer scholar who focused in Greek folk art, and in 1927 she curated the exhibition of the Pan-Hellenic Greek folk art in the Delphic festivals that Angelos Kelianos and Eva Palmer had organized. Her major work was Sarakatsani, a fascinating book resulting from her in-situ research on the community of Sarakatsani. We decided to add discreetly our exhibition items to the permanent ones. Our intention was to create a polyphony and a symbiotic relationship with the folklorist and her objects. Our research and production was differentiated from Hadjimichali by its post-human approach, centered on the animal and the relationships in between goats, men, territory. Issues of sovereignty were also present. We thus introduced the visitors to the reading of a poetic itinerary inside the museum. The root traces were composed by sound videos, performative texts and devices. We understood the creation process of the exhibition as a kind of rumination of the created archive. Our main exhibition items were several kinds of performative apparatuses. The intention was composing a carnival dress for polyphonic reading. The dress followed selected body parts of the animal in analogy with the ancient tragic performer. So I made the Aegis, you see here at the left. I composed in one item the collected text, fragments of interviews, poems and testimonia, music, an animal bell was hanging and mapping, all this on a parchment, the processed liver coming from a young female goat. With its two writing surfaces that had a certain transparency, it was at the same time a protection and a mask, a reading device and a map, a dress and a concealment. This is the Aegis. I used this apparatus in the performances together with an apron made by black women 100 years before. The Aegis put the skin of the animal in contact with my body, the skin that was the imprint of the land to a body. It is the land and its voices that are speaking when I wear it and when I read. During the exhibition, two evening polyphonic performances were held. You have seen some photos of them. I did several other performances, each different from the previous, using the texts each time differently. The poems I have written appeared in a book called Chimera. I recomposed for it the material that was on the Aegis, creating a dialogical polyphony while keeping the identities of the speaking personas, mixed with my own poems. Throughout the book, there is the antiphony of the animals, the shepherds, the travelers, scientists, ancient poets, so that my own voice, I would like to make her disappear among the rest. At the performance reading of the book launch, we went to the restaurant Epiros of the central meat market of Athens, and the pages of the book printed were used as supla, read aloud by all the French banqueteers, keeping polyphony and isophony. You can see them here on after the end of the meal. So the last performance is from Pen in Nisiros. It was from a festival curated by Nadia Argyropoulou. I am there as the actor and the goats are the chorus. And I think they are the best audience for my performances. So I will show you this thing. Η μητέρα μου έλεγε, η γιαγιά μου έλεγε, να έχεις την ευχή μου από μέσα από το βρακί μου. Τον θυμίδεται πίτα θέτης κατά δάκρυ γέλωσα. Ο μητέκνο νεμόν Αθήνης έτρεχον ένα εκούσα. Δεν ήμουν κάποτε κι εγώ τζίτζικας, παιδί, πουλί, γίδα, λουλούδι, με καρφωμένη την τροβοσκίδα, να ρουθώ δροσιά, να τραγουδώ μέσα στη ζέστη, ξερός από το θέρος αγαϊδουράντα, υγρός από τον πόθο. Τα πράγματα, τα ζώα. Τα πράγματα. Τι κουβαλάς μαζί όταν φεύγεις?
Τα πράγματα, τα ζώα, τα ζωντανά, τα πράγματα, τα πράγματα.
Τι κουβαλάς μαζί όταν φεύγεις?
Τι κουβαλάς μαζί όταν φεύγεις?
Το σκοτάδι μου. Το δικό μου κομμάτι σκοτάδι.
Το δικό μου κομμάτι σκοτάδι.
Τι κουβαλάς μαζί όταν φεύγεις?
Τι κουβαλάς μαζί όταν φεύγεις?
Στο σώμα τα σημάδια.
Στο σώμα τα σημάδια.
Τι κουβαλάς όταν φεύγεις?
Τι κουβαλάς μαζί όταν φεύγεις?
Λυσμόν ημένες πράξεις.
Λυσμόν ημένες πράξεις.
Λυσμόν ημένες πράξεις. Κομμάτια της
ζωής.
Πεθάκινες φυλαχτώ. Παλαιό κόκκινο σταυρό. Για να αλλάξω σπίτι, έπρεπε να διαλέξω τα πράγματα, τα θράψματα που τα παιδιά μου είχαν αφήσει πίσω, προτού με αφήσουν για τη δική τους ζωή. Ευχαριστώ.